Hello everyone, and welcome back to my Efficient Design Series in Kerbal Space Program 0.24.2. In this episode, I want to start working towards building a Kerbin orbit station. I mean, we have tons and tons of funds, and we've got a fair amount of science, though not quite enough for what I want to do. We need to unlock some more technologies, but I think a Kerbin orbit station is something that a space agency with these kinds of funds should aim towards. And so that's the main goal, but I don't think we're there yet because we don't have the large docking ports. You can see we've unlocked these guys, and I'm going to use some of our science now to unlock this tier. And the senior docking ports are there, but we're shy of science, about to the tune of 70, and so we need at least 70 science in order to get to where we want to be, and also we probably want one of these multi-point connectors as well. So that's the goal, getting that science in this episode and maybe starting up on it, but I've got an ambitious plan, so we will take a look at that. So the question that came to me was, well, we had the nuclear stage separate from the lander, and that was a very efficient and very good idea with the 10K probe, but I wanted to try making a lander with the nuclear engine. Now, this is the Elegant Design Bureau and all that, which means that I try and keep things streamlined, and it's really hard to make a streamlined lander with a nuclear engine as its main stage, because of course the nuclear engine is really tall. So it's not going to look particularly pretty, but here's what I came up with. Yeah, I mean, at least it's got a streamlined thing to it. You can see the nuke is right there. And if we lower the landing gear, it's like that. These tanks are actually on these struts. I rarely use the struts because, modular girder segments. I rarely use them because they're so heavy, and these are even worse. But yeah, these are really heavy. In fact, there's 8 of them involved in this. One here, and then four-way symmetry. And so that amounts to a ton, which is pretty heavy for this craft, which has a Science Junior and 2 goo containers and normal experiments, and that's what it's trying to bring to various locations. Now, the thrust weight ratio of this is pretty low. We've got a 60 kilonewton engine, and the whole thing weighs more than 14 tons, so you're looking at less than 0.5 g's worth of thrust weight ratio. So not the greatest thing as far as trying to land on heavier objects, but most of the objects in the Kerbal system are pretty low G. I mean, you talk about Moho, Gili, the Moon, Minmus. I think Duna would be tough with the atmosphere, but maybe Duna, certainly Ike, a few of Jupiter's moons except for Tylo and Lathe, and of course Ilu, Drez, are all within the capabilities of this in terms of its ability to lift off of them. So that's pretty good. So here we've got one of the one ton tanks in the center here. Hopefully I've got all the fuel lines hooked up properly. I didn't take any chance on strutting. So you see the normal sort of thing that I've been doing in this series with getting these tanks on the side of the center tank there, and then struts to attach these guys on the side, and sort of like that. And it was also a consideration that I needed the landing gear to extend below the nuclear stage. So that's the idea, and we'll see how it works, shall we? So it's launching on the OV-X, pretty much at the capacity of the OV-X, and that was also an important thing. I can't possibly put more fuel on the probe. I wish I could make it more streamlined, but this is about as good as I can get it. Alright, so let's take it up to launch pad. Alright, here we go, throttle up. Let's check where we are. Here's the thing, I want to make sure that I can land the OVX in daylight, and so we're sort of at night here. So let's time warp a little bit, through the entire night, so that we don't have to land the OVX in the dark, bouncing back and forth between realism overhaul and this. I always have to get used to the time warping again, because the steps in time warping are different for realism overhaul compared to this. Anyway, here we are, and let's go. Okay, since it's right at capacity, you know, it's going to be a slow launch. You'll note that I put a docking port at the top there, and that should give you a hint. This thing is going to be either docking with some sort of Kerbal manned craft, if you will, or the station that we're going to build. And so the Kerbals are going to be able to retrieve the science, so it doesn't have to come all the way down back to Kerbin, and that's why no parachutes, right? And it saves the parachute mass. Now, it doesn't have any RCS, so we'll have to have a tug on the station in order to bring it into the station if that's what we're going to do. Otherwise, if it's a Kerbal craft, if with Kerbals in, then they can maneuver towards it. It occurs to me that I haven't even decided where we're going yet. That's fine. I have decided, actually. I just haven't mentioned it. I think we're going to go to Gilly. We have a Gilly contract here. And so I want to satisfy that with this first. But obviously, this thing has enough Delta V that we could go to Gilly and come back, and we'll still be full of fuel. So, yeah, it's not going to be just Gilly. Okay, that's a nice tight orbit that we can retrieve the OV-X from. Now, we're not in the proper phase angle for Gilly yet, so we can't just go ahead with transferring this. But anyway, we're going to be bringing the OV-X back down first. Let's see how much fuel we ended up left in it. Decouple. Okay, that's underway. This, pretty tight, yeah. Pretty tight. What is that in terms of percentage? Less than 3% of its fuel left. Yeah. Okay. And, well, let's start out the nuclear stage. Looking at this, I don't know what the fairings are gonna do. Ooh, yeah, I was afraid of that. Okay. Yeah, well, I wasn't quite afraid of that. I didn't realize it was gonna do that. I was sort of more of afraid of it. I don't know how, if the fairings are either, you know, physically relevant or physically not relevant, then these always seem to be physically relevant. Much more so this time than normal. I suppose, could we knock it off? No. How do we get rid of this thing? Oh, this is going to be interesting. Okay, let's get the solar panel. Oh, it's sort of wanting to go free. I feel that it wants to go free. I've got the solar panels out so that we can make sure that that's all right. I'm almost tempted to bring this back over to the OVX and sort of have the OVX help knock that thing out. Okay, good. That was weird. Yeah, I was sort of either expecting nothing or an explosion, but that was a little bit different. Okay, well, this thing is all set to go. No problems. Well, I mean, we're sort of lucky on that fairing thing, but yeah, no problems. Okay, so that is in orbit safely, and now we want to bring this back. The plan from this altitude is 35 kilometers, I believe. I'm just recalling what I have. I actually have it all written down. I really should check. But aiming for over the peninsula there, 35 kilometers, but let's get over there. The planet rotates and all that. I think I've got it in the right location. Okay, that's close enough. We're not quite at the right inclination, though. Close enough, but I really should adjust that next time. Otherwise, you see, if we're too far south, and you can see we're a little bit south now, we're more likely to hit water. If we are hitting the KSC right on, we have more land to work with. Okay, anyway, and yep, let's just continue on. I really need to make sure that I'm not flat against the atmosphere. All my testing had me exactly in line with my retrograde vector. So if I tilt away from that, I'm going to add more drag, which means I'm going to end up falling short perhaps. Of course, if I end up hitting the coast at higher than 34, maybe I'll want to deviate more from my retrograde vector. Indeed, that's looking likely. Okay, maybe we should deflect. Hopefully not wanting lift, I want drag. And not too much so that I flip over or anything. It's not going to be possible to really deflect too much. The atmosphere is eventually going to force me towards the retrograde vector. I can slow down manually too. Almost out of fuel. I want to keep some for a soft landing. And let's try the parachutes early, perhaps. Okay, pre-deployment. Out they go. SAS off. Now obviously I could retain more fuel, carry a lighter load as payload, and I'd be able to just thrust my way down and make sure I hit it. But I want to limit how much fuel I have to reserve for all this. My current target is 10 kilometers. As long as I get within 10 kilometers, I'm sort of happy. And of course, this is water safe. We've tested that before, so that's also a plus. Okay, full chute deployment brings us to 7.8. I'll use the engines to slow us down once we get within 100 meters. Okay, all nice and floaty. Let's recover. Okay, so obviously no science there, but we got 97.6% of our total funds, and that's the bulk of it, so that's satisfactory. Now, let's go to tracking station. And what I need is Eve to be 30... it needs to be behind Kerbin by 54 degrees. Okay. You know, we've got a lot of delta V in the probe. This is obviously not 54 degrees. This is more like the 35 degrees. But maybe it's close enough. But then again, with Eve, it's tough. Let's go to the probe and see what it would cost to transfer now. Oh, just in case you're wondering, by my calculations, this lander has about 7,500 meters per second. It's 7,700, but giving it some buffer, let's call it 7,500 meters per second of delta V. So that is a hefty amount of delta V for a lander. But again, it's at the expense of thrust to weight, so it can't deal with very serious objects. So the objects where you'd need 7,000 odd delta V to get on and off of, you can't deal with. So it's more of a multi-target sort of thing rather than, well, we're not too far off it looks like, rather than some sort of, you know, do everything kind of lander. It's not a do everything kind of lander. But it can handle more than one mission at a time. I think we must be at one of the nodes, ascending or descending. Otherwise it wouldn't be this easy. I certainly don't see any ascending or descending node floating out there. Okay, well, Eve periapsis of 430 meters, maybe a little bit too close. It looks like we can get arbitrarily close to Eve. We will aerobrake even though we have the delta V to slow down manually. No point having to refuel this constantly like that. So best to just get a, okay, 87 kilometers seems fine. Okay. Not bad looking. I mean, with the plume and all. How much do we get for fulfilling the Gilly contract, I wonder? Doesn't say here, obviously. And when I say what do we get for it, I'm mainly looking for science, right? We need that 70 science. We might have to transmit some of the science back, even though I normally would want to retrieve it from this. Just so that we get the science we need to start working on that station. We ended up quite late, actually, on this burn. Didn't expect that, so we're probably going to be a bit off. Okay, well, it's not showing me much, so let me replot, just so that I can have some sort of frame of reference. I get the feeling it's trying to get me to use a lot more of my delta V than I'd like for this. Yeah, that last maneuver seemed to have really messed me up. Wow, it's costing more and more each time too. Yeah, the game has detected that I have an obscene amount of delta V in this craft and has decided to try and plot my overthrow, trying to make it hard on me. I had a very nice encounter initially, and now, but I mean, I don't fault the fact that I had to correct the initial burn, but that little correction maneuver that I had plotted just recently did not do the trick. Now, obviously, I'm doing it off of the Holman transfer. We're not doing a Holman transfer. It's actually a little bit away from that. So we're actually using an off-plane transfer. And that is what's probably throwing me off a little bit, in that I have to hit that pretty close to make it work. Okay, that looks like the minimum. Alright, that's close enough for me. Alright, let's get over there. Okay, and this probe will be returning to Kerbin. That I want to guarantee. Okay, so here is our approach to Eve, and right away we see that we've got problems here because we're way off from Gilly. Though the outward trajectory doesn't look... well, no, it's pretty bad too. Oh, but we're going clockwise, aren't we? Oh, that's not good. Okay, so we have to flip around and everything. I don't think I did that right at all. Okay, that looks good. Let's try that correction. It's a little bit expensive. Again, the game is clearly plotting to make sure that I spend as much of my delta V as possible. Okay, but here we are in the Eve sphere of influence. Can we see Eve yet? Probably not. It's too far away. Okay. Okay, now I'm going to use air braking calculator to figure out how close we need to be to air brake properly. And properly, I mean I want to hit Gilly's orbit somehow, so 45,000 kilometers on the apoapsis. So I'll be right back with that. Okay, it gives me 75,600. So. Okay, well, it's too variable right now for me to correct. Let's get in a little bit closer, shall we? So I guess, oh, there it is. Okay, I was trying to figure out where it was. All right, let's point away from it. Okay. Okay, let's see our situation. It's a little bit high. Okay, that's about right. Here we go. And I'll retract the solar panels now. Time for Eve aerobraking. Some of the most serious aerobraking you'll encounter in Kerbal Space Program, aside from Joule, or I guess, I don't know, the Sun? No, I don't think so. Aside from Joule. Okay, it looks like we got aerobrake on the dark side. We could potentially do some science to fulfill part of the Eve contract as well. I don't think we've done... trying to sort out all of my series is tough, but I don't think we've done science around Eve in this one, have we? Temperature is a long shot. Let's try a gravity scan. No, it looks like we haven't. Okay, let's transmit that one. Yeah, though we're a little bit tight on electric charge now, thanks to that. Let me hold off on that, and we'll let the fireworks, the re-entry heat, do all the work in terms of our lighting. I'll turn those lights off for now. So we've transmitted. We'll achieve orbit around Eve and satisfy that, though we could probably transmit some more data and thereby fulfill, well, get some more science. Very important. Are we sufficiently in the atmosphere? No. Temperature data. I'm going to keep that for now and transmit it once we're outside the atmosphere, because I'm always worried about the antenna snapping off. Well, we're already pretty much at our periapsis. How are we doing on the aerobraking? We didn't get much of re-entry heat, did we? Let's turn the lights back on. Just because. Okay, 40 degrees off from Gilly. That's more than I was bargaining for. Okay, well, we'll wait until we've fully aerobraked and gotten out of the atmosphere. Is this near to Eve right now for gravity data? Oh, okay, well. Doesn't like the atmosphere anyway. Okay, I'll transmit that first. And I'll transmit a temperature scan. We should be outside the atmosphere, so solar panels back out. Okay, the electric charge is replenishing, so I'll transmit this. Okay. Now, we need to do some serious corrections here. And better to do it on the... No, that's further out anyway. Aha! Yeah, that's good. Ah, even an encounter, wow. Getting an encounter with Gilly like that, that's good stuff. Okay. Heading out, so a little bit further away from the purple planet. Okay, Gilly encounter, periapsis 111 kilometers. It just occurred to me to point out that even though our thrust-weight ratio is very low on this, that's the initial thrust-weight ratio. By the time it's burned all of its fuel, the thrust-weight ratio ends up being close, more than one actually. So that's another point. If we do make interplanetary transfers with it, that probably means we're going to end up with a higher thrust weight ratio once we reach our destination, which means we can actually land on larger bodies, but then taking off again is a little bit tough because we're gonna need a lot of fuel to land on those sorts of places. This is a very brief encounter indeed. Oh, in fact, it's too brief now. I think it's decided I don't even have a periapsis. Guess the simple thing to do would be just to burn towards my target, maybe. Yeah, okay, there we go. That's quite a swing, isn't it? Look at that. Not quite in orbit yet. It's real insistent about not being in orbit. There we go, finally. Okay. Ten kilometers might be a little bit too close to Gilly. It'll probably stop me from time warping if I'm that close. I want to be in a little bit higher of an orbit. For now, anyway. Okay, we are in orbit. We fulfilled that part of the contract. Yep, let's do some science. Gravity data. High over Gilly. We'll transmit that. Okay, transmission complete. We've got that data. Thermometer, barometer, and seismometer won't be workable here. Let's see now. We will probably want to land. Landing location's not all that great. Let's tighten our orbit first. Well, actually, this direction is fine. Let's go around. That's good. We'll aim for this batch now. I was going around the wrong way, so I didn't have the right idea going. Okay, landing on Gilly. It's more a matter of being time-consuming than actually difficult. As long as you've got the fuel, of course. Yep, just gonna land here. Looks like a perfectly good spot to be. Now, we should be in space close to Gilly by now. See if there's a temperature scan involved. Nope. Gravity data? Still high. Well, we can... Well, I'd want one goo container close to Gilly and one goo container on the ground. Won't let me time warp, but it's not close to Gilly. Okay, now let's try things. Well, now we're near Gilly, so we get that. I can observe Mystery Goo while it's doing that. I'm going to keep that one. And how about the thermometer now? Oh, it's like that, is it? It's not going to actually let me do a thermometer reading. Okay, pressure data is pointless, actually. We have down-facing lights, but they're sort of getting dissipated by the solar panels. The solar panels are sort of in their way. But you can sort of see their glow on the surface right now. Okay, contact and... Okay, so right when I touched down, I actually ran out of disk space. Not totally ran out of disk space, it's just on the drive that I was recording on. I have plenty of this space, it's just distributed on multiple external drives, and I have to remember to shuffle the files back out when I need the space. So, what you missed was we landed, and I did some science, so let me just go through that science again. We did the Science Junior, I decided to keep the data, obviously, 225. I did one of the goo containers, I forget which one, this is the in-space one, this one is the on-the-surface one. And so we observed the goo, and we keep that data. We got a temperature reading. We got the seismometer reading. The seismometer had 180 signs to it. And of course, we also got the gravioli. And so that's 180 science as well. So what I was going to say before I realized that I wasn't recording was that we'll keep it here for now. I think we're at the end of my time and obviously at the end of my space as well, though not really. Anyway, but yeah, I think in the next episode I will either start off with bringing this back over to Kerbin and transferring the data using a Kerbal, so a Kerbal will dock with this and I grab the data and then return to the surface, or I'm going to start off with building the station, because we've got enough science to unlock the big docking ports now, and I don't see any reason why we shouldn't start constructing that station, in which case this and then if we get the station up and we get Tug, then this data can be brought to the station, though maybe that's an extra step. We could probably dock with this with a Kerbal and bring it directly down to the surface rather than having any sort of docking with the station. That's probably more direct. So obviously if this had RCS on it, we would just dock with the station. That would actually be a little bit more convenient, but since it doesn't, it's a different story. So yep, that's the plan for the next episode. This mission has been successful so far. We've got more than half of our fuel left, which means way more than half of our Delta V left. And so probably on the order of definitely more than 4,000 meters per second of Delta V left on this lander. So good stuff. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please do press like. If you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below. And I'll see you next time.